This week, Areti speaks with John Wheeler.
Examining this idea of an I. People have resistance to that. I've heard it. People say, well, who is this I that's looking back?
That's just a bunch of verbiage, conceptual verbiage. The easiest way to see this is just pause right now, without any thought, without any concept. What is wrong with right now? What is this condition that's basically self-evident? So one of the things that's interesting to me in looking at this is if you look at a question or a problem or a doubt or a fear or a goal or problems, all of these are created in thought. Without thought, those don't exist. So all of our problems and all of our issues and all of our questions and doubts and all of our seeking is all sustained and created in the thought process. And without that thought process, or noticing what's here independent of that thought process, is what this is. That part doesn't have to be brought into the picture. It's not manufactured, it's not attained. It's really what you are, kind of free of this attention going into thought. So it's very key there, because you realize all of your problems are created in thought. Now, that often leads people to the position that if I eliminate thought, I will be free. It's very reasonable, but it's a partial, it's not the depth of understanding. Because many people have tried that, you know, I've tried that too, to be very still, quiet, you know, meditate and so on. But one of the flaws in that is you can't stop your thoughts. But the truth of it is it turns out it's not the thoughts that are the problem. So it calls for a little bit deeper understanding of really what's going on. So the next question is, what is it about those thoughts that's the problem? We have many thoughts during the day, and most of them cause no problem whatsoever. But there's a certain group or a certain type of thoughts that are the ones that seem kind of more
unsettling.
Sticky.
Unsettling?
Yeah.
More sticky.
So the next way of looking at that would be to see, well, or to wonder and examine, what is it about those thoughts? And one way of looking at it is you start to notice that all of those thoughts are about me. You know, I'm not good enough. I've got a problem. I'm a seeker. I'm not enlightened. I don't have the final understanding. I don't see. I don't understand, or whatever. Or I had it and I lost it. So the common thread in all of that thinking really is it's all in reference to my sense of self. All of those thoughts are a description or some kind of statement or condition of this sense of me. So
explain that condition of this sense of being.
I am not enlightened. Mm-hmm. I am no good. I am not free. I don't have the understanding. All those statements are basically descriptions of me. And in a certain way, they're all negative. They're all limited. They're all incomplete. So these suffering concepts are really all about my mind's conception of who I am. So if I sit here and I think, you know, this light is shining, there's no problem with that. But if I think I am no good, then I've got this problem on my hands for this sense of self. So a way of describing those troubling thoughts is basically self-centered thinking. So then, of course, someone would say, well, if I get rid of my self-centered thinking, I'll be free. You know, I can purify my mind, be less selfish, think of others, and all this kind of thing. But that also turns out to be kind of an incomplete understanding, because really what's driving that, when you really look very closely, is the belief that what I am is a limited, separated person with a problem. And it turns out that that itself is a concept, it's an assumption. Because if that thought appears or doesn't appear, your natural presence, what you are, your existence, remains as it is. So the root of all of the troubling thoughts is this concept that that what I am is a limited me, so that thought is the cause, and all of these descriptions of that me are the effect. You know, so again, going back to looking at seeking, your being right now, whatever you are, is not seeking. The mind isn't the problem. It's the belief that what I am is a limited entity. That's the problem. And of course, that whole, there's no thing to do, there's nothing. All the non of those, all the things, is all just simply the non-conceptual reality.
Yeah.
So. Powerful in the sense that if it's just only the perceiving, then it's another way of showing how that entity of this limited I is imaginary and doesn't even exist. Because there is no separate I apart from the seeing that has all these attributes of good, bad, I'm this, I'm whatever. So to see the immediacy and the complete totality of the seeing as what is real, it just kind of exposes the conceptual nature of this entity that is the root of all suffering. Because the perceiving isn't suffering.
No.
The perceiving isn't worried that it's not enlightened or whatever. What does language do? Language creates the abstraction of a symbol that represents seemingly something and then takes on a life of its own. It's very powerful because mathematics and language and all these things have only come to be because of this ability to conceptualize. But it can also become a bondage in the sense that we start believing that the conceptualizing, that the concepts themselves are independent realities. And getting back to what I said way at the beginning, was the root, the most the core one is the concept of the I.
Yeah.
Because that concept of the I, it's almost as if that's a thing, that's what I am.
Age three.
It has all of these negative attributes that are all defined in language, and that's what I am, but that's not what you are. The pointer pause thought, you know, after looking this, you don't even need to go into that pause thought thing because it doesn't matter whether there's thought or not. Thought appears in an undeniable space of whatever you want to call it. So that's just a temporary technique or a way of talking. Because the truth is, can you pause thought? Even if you wanted a so-called pause thought, for somebody that's completely fascinated by thought and thinks that's all the reality, say, hey, just, you know, just kind of take the emphasis off that for a second and see if there's anything else here, you know. But there's nobody there to pause thought. And thought doesn't disturb, like when you say you pause thought, what's there? Well, then notice that as thoughts come back and play through, do they change that? So we don't have to talk about pausing thought anymore.
Even the
thought, I'm going to full stop, is itself another thought.
It's a thought, yeah.
It's just a way of noticing that non-conceptual space of who you are. Mm. It's all a shell game, really, because one, that's always present. It's totally shining in plain view. You've never moved out of it. All these thoughts and appearances are, as we said earlier, are actually only that anyway.
Yeah.
So all of these pointers and techniques and teachings are they're partial, incomplete, inconclusive, and erroneous,
yeah.
ultimately.
Yeah.
But if they can point to exactly what you're seeing and knowing, which is that then they've done their job. Then there's a point in this too where if you jump back into this, let's talk about it. What is it? Let's examine it. Where it's kind of self-defeating.
Yeah.